Being a 2023 bride myself, diving into these trends was so exciting, and it was so much better than spring trends because you know what? A lot of these fashion watchdogs are saying the exact same thing when it comes to wedding trends for 2023. Hey, my name's Amanda, and today we are diving into the analytical fashion girly life and looking at the likes of
brides,
who, what, where, the knot, Vogue, Mary Claire, and my new favorite, Carats and Cake, to look at what fashion designers and fashion journalists are saying about the wedding dress trends for 2023. I took each individual trend list, put them in this little chart, and then started to cross-section, and you guys, there are so many journalists saying the same things, which makes these videos that much more easy to produce and very exciting for myself. So let's dive right into the wedding dress trends for 2023. A quick disclaimer, you guys, these are just trends. These are just things that you may be seeing a little bit more when it comes to shopping for wedding dresses. You're gonna wanna choose what suits you best. And that is what all these journalists have been saying, is wear what makes you feel good. So just take this video as maybe a little inspiration before you head out wedding dress shopping, or even a little push in the right direction for you if you've already went out and you haven't found what you love. Wear what you love. And that's my disclaimer. The first trend that we are seeing is sleeves, and sleeves in many different ways, not just the long sleeve. I'm gonna start out with the puffed out sleeves. This one is really fun because Andrea Hawks of Andrea Hawks Bridal actually wore a dress designed by herself on her own line with these beautiful long sleeves. Who What Wear really was citing that puff sleeves are going to be a really big trend because we love the romanticism and a little bit of drama. If you are a minimalist girly, adding a little puff sleeve is maybe a way to elevate that dress while still staying in line with those really sleek and minimal designs. They were also showing us that whether you have an opaque or a see-through sleeve, or even just choosing one, could be an option that you've never thought of before. Sticking on the sleeves, this is what I think of when I think of wedding sleeves. And this is something that I definitely tried on as well when I was going for my trials. And brides stated, sumptuous sleeves. Those really romantic sleeves that kind of bring you back to the 1800s. We have been seeing sleeves like this and silhouettes like this since the beginning of time when it comes to wedding dresses. I wanted to also curve the sleeve talk, not into just long sleeves, but also off the shoulder. There's two versions of this that Carats and Cake had mentioned in their article. One was just the simple off the shoulder. You can have a really nice, beautiful drop sleeve, which can really add some romance to a dress that maybe you hadn't considered before. When you are in a bridal shop, oftentimes they can add these to a dress. So if you are wearing maybe a strapless, beautiful dress, ask them, do you have a sleeve that I could add to this? I did it, and it really gave me the option to upscale that dress the way that I saw it. Adding a long sleeve or even that drop sleeve is a way of kind of changing and transitioning your dress throughout the day, and or making it a little bit more bespoke and custom to you without having an entire dress created custom. This sheer transparent sleeve that just comes across. I didn't do this for my dress design. If you don't know already, I'm actually custom designing my own wedding dress, but this is something I adore so much. And oh my gosh, if you have a dress like this, please send it to me on Instagram. The second that Carats and Cake mentioned was the off the shoulder, but with sleeves. So this is kind of just showcasing how you can do an off the shoulder with that slight little piece of fabric, or even a full puff sleeve, which kind of transitions back up to the top of this trend. Some options you may not have considered is a sleeve that's not even attached to your dress. This is something that you can get from Etsy. I have just a few videos here. Literally, if you go on Etsy and you look up wedding sleeve, I think that's what I did. You can find lace, you can find satin. One thing I want you to make sure though is you find the exact white. Maybe going with a lace or a transparent fabric would be a little bit better of a deal, because you wouldn't want to have a pure white and a little off white. It would just look a little bit off on your day, unless that's what you love. Vogue also did a tiny nod towards the cap sleeve. Now, whilst I don't feel like this is going to be a huge trend, the cap sleeve, it's just another way of saying if this is an area that you aren't super comfortable with and you feel more comfortable in a cap sleeve, it's out there, babe, and it's looking for you. The second trend is a sweeping declaration of romantic elements. We know when something looks romantic. It looks timeless. It looks like it should be in the cinema.
I was 9 years old and you had your arms around me because you were teaching me to skate backwards. And suddenly you kissed me.
And romantic elements, when I think of that and how I kind of group these together, were the 3D florals. That's so huge, starting from last year and moving forward. Embellishments, we're talking really jazzy embellishments like pearls and things that you would see in The Great Gatsby. And we're also talking about high necklines. Mary Claire said this, and they labeled theirs as true romance. And in their kind of collage, you can see there's a lot of different things going on here. So I feel like some other publications broke this down better, but they helped me group them together. So let's go to Carats and Cake and start out with 3D florals. 3D florals have been seen in so many different types of lace, in florals by themselves. Rosettes themselves are a huge trend for regular fashion this year in streetwear fashion. But these beautiful rosettes have been seen on Galia Lahav dresses, and so many other designers are really opting for this, like Ali Saab. He has been making some incredible gowns. This is a Lebanese designer who just loves the intricate design, like a 3D floral. The Knot actually cited that oversized florals would be a part of this romantic element. And what we're seeing here in these dresses are those really big pops of just one single floral, or down the skirt, a couple of bigger elements that aren't necessarily integrated into a lace, but them themselves are standing alone on the fabric. The Knot also cited the embroidered eminence. And I feel like this one flows really nice from the florals, because you'll also see an embroidery. We'll also get a lot of floral design here. This one designer, Mira Zwillinger, I believe it is two women. I believe it's a mother and daughter duo, and their dresses are so romantic. And it's because of this embroidery that follows and flows all the way down and just kind of gives you this stream of romance. So now that we've covered the floral part of things, let's talk about the ornate embellishments that can also add so much romance and timelessness. For many seasons now, we have been seeing a more minimal design take the main stage, where we've had elopements and smaller weddings because of the pandemic. We're still kind of in that hangover after the pandemic when it comes to weddings. Trust me, I know. But whether we're talking about jewels, diamonds, crystals, or all over beading, this is starting to take the main stage once again, because these dresses, they take so long to be made that a lot of us just didn't have that lead time. The Knot kind of called this the jazz era. And this is really looking at the 1920s, when we're talking about flapper dresses, two different publications citing this in the same way. Two last notes when it comes to romantic elements is high shine, mentioned by Mary Claire. You're gonna see a lot of satin and a lot of silk kind of dresses coming back to the forefront, and even dresses that are fully sparkle. But Vogue cited that high necklines, like I mentioned earlier, a really nice romantic kind of cut that shows off the collarbone and the shoulders. A lot of people, a lot of publications, every single year, year after year, I will always see them go back to mention Grace Kelly's dress. And that is what you are seeing here. I love how Vogue did this spread. They showed high necklines in three different ways. One with a cap sleeve, full lace. One that looks more like the dress that I'm wearing with that cross in the middle. And one where it is a full, all the way down to the wrist, covered full neckline. That is the high neckline with a turtleneck. And this bride looks absolutely stunning. This is the trend that I saw sweep almost nearly every single list, and it has me absolutely buzzing. And that is bows. Bows are going to be huge. They're gonna be big in size, they're gonna be small in size, and they're just gonna be that little added touch that is like the cherry on top, or rather should I say the bow on top. So let's dive into that. Wrapped in a bow is what The Knot called this, and they're really saying that from oversized bows to those extended trains, you're going to be noting bows much more availability. What I love about a feature like a bow is you could be a minimalist bride girly and maybe say, "Ooh, I just want something little to add a little bit of personality that screams me." So if you love a bow, this could be a way to add a little something, a little personalization to your dress. And then who, what, wear this half penny London dress, that huge bow on the side, very Met Gala, very editorial, but I love it. You would have to be a very specific bride to want that on your wedding day, but if you are, oh my God, I just love bows so much. In the Who What Wear document as well, this is kind of the dress that I wanted to draw your attention to, the Whistles dress. That is an example of a minimalist bride who has opted to add a little something special to her wedding dress. Going down to Mary Claire, the coupe de beau is what they called their little section here. And I love as well how we're integrating not only a maxi and a midi, but also a mini when it comes to beau. This could be maybe a great option for your second dress. We will also get to that. Carats and Cake also mentioned bow details and saying that it's that little 1990s Gwyneth Paltrow in the best way possible. These dresses are so stunning, and in Carats and Cake, they also showed, because I think in all of these photos, we've just seen that satin kind of bow or silk bow. They've also showed how you can have like a diamante kind of bow. So really the sky is the limit, or even if you just add kind of a ribbon around to define that waistline, in organza. We'd love to see it. Okay, so before I totally lose the plot here, let's go to the next trend, which is 90s silhouettes. We've already talked a little bit about this, and in Spring Trends 2023, 90s minimalism is absolutely huge this year, and it is coming back in full force in bridal fashion as well. When we're talking about 90s silhouettes, we're talking about minimalism that 90s serves, but it's kind of a relaxed minimalism. With this, we are really talking about a bias cut. And if you've never heard of a bias cut before, and I've only heard about this because of customizing my own wedding dress and learning a lot more about the process, I just wanted to show you a bias cut is basically a technique that they use to sew and cut the dress so that it can lay really nice and tight, maybe not tight, but closely to your body, and then flow away. Less fit and flare, more fit and flow is what I think of when I think of a bias cut. So here as well in Vogue, showing off that 90s minimalism, these dresses are simple, stunning, and timeless. A little bit of transparent where you've got the chiffon or an organza, and then as well with the satin. That nod to 90s was also mentioned in the knot, and specifically they wanted to mention that simple cut with the high neckline, so elegant, a square neckline as well being part of the conversation once again, and a little bit of shoulder pad action. That is very 90s. Body hugging silhouettes is what brides said that this was, and basically saying ditching that tradition and now opting for pieces that are more form-fitting and bold. Who What Wear brought this in through the square neckline, which I have already mentioned, so mentioned now in two publications. The square neckline is going to be a big one, and even in their article there, they were just saying that you can layer it with different pieces, and that's actually going to be one of the added notes on the end of this video. Also, this is really cute. If you like a square neckline but you don't see it in your wedding dress, consider it for your bridal shower, your engagement party, or whatever event you may be throwing to celebrate. Okay, let's talk about maximalism. Maximalism is something that's been coming back more and more and more in regular fashion, street fashion, and bridal fashion. And that's because we are done with our sweatpants, okay? As much as I've talked about minimalism and minimalist brides and those really clean lines throughout this video, know that there's always a range, especially when it comes to wedding season, because we're all different. So maximalism will always enter the chat, but what is really talked about in Vogue is unexpected fabrics. And honestly, I didn't expect to see this at all because I would have never thought about this. Two Vivian Westwood dresses that catch your attention here, one in like this buttery yellow color, one that has mirrors on it. You could add a, you know, masquerade feel to your wedding dress, or you could even choose something like a tweed or a boucle. Unexpected fabrics? Why not? Mary Claire cited this as pump up the volume on the runway, especially for the bridal trends for 2023 and 2024. We've been seeing a lot of volume in those skirts, and we'll get to that even more in a second. Carats and Cake were citing transparency as one of the most ubiquitous trends that we've been seeing across the board, whether that be street fashion or wedding fashion. Also, remember that this bride in the second image has a cape. You're seeing those florals, that lace be cut up and dispersed throughout the dress, which we have already kind of talked about, and Carats and Cake as well, just showing off how you could do an overall lace but still incorporate transparency to give it a modern flair. Now, where are my princess girlies at? Don't worry, the ball gown is back in business. It really started to come back on the scene just last year. Bridgerton has been a big thing. The new season just came out. Let me know if you've seen it. I loved it. And when we're talking about ball gowns, specifically in this trend report by Carats and Cake, it's more that bodice that's really nice and tight that holds itself up with a corset at the back, and then that big A-line finish out in the skirt. It's ruffles, it's lace, it's sleeves, it's puff sleeves, it's everything. The knot made a really good note that we are doing that motion towards maximalism because micro weddings and elopements certainly had their moments in the past years, but according to the Real Wedding Study, large weddings are now back and better than ever. And this is what I was talking about earlier in the video when I said we would get to it, where it's that overall dress that sparkle. This third dress does look quite minimal, but if you looked at it closely, you would notice the entire thing was sparkle. Just like bows, this next trend was seen across nearly every single publication, and that is a touch of color. Pastels specifically have been taking the main stage. So if we look at these photos provided by The Knot, we're really leaning into those pastel pinks and blues. Hey, you could be yourself, you're something blue all over. And as well, florals and just adding a little bit of floral to your dress, whether that be through a print or we come down to what Brides is saying, hints of color. You're seeing it as well in the green in that lace. That is the 3D lace, another trend we already mentioned, but bringing out a pop of color in the green of the leaves. Carats and Cake also said color, just color. Whether you are adding a piece on your skirt that's something blue that you can remove later in this second image, or the entire dress is something different, or this dress here that is full blue with a white flower on it to still give it that elegance of a wedding. Monique Lhuillier is the designer that makes the second dress here, and it is so romantic. Like, I picture walking through the Hall of Mirrors in Versailles wearing this dress. You'll notice her name throughout quite a few different photos here, and you'll just see that romance is threaded through every single trend. Soft color, also mentioned in the Vogue article, and this bride was wearing an Oscar de la Renta. As soon as I saw this dress, something in me just said, that's gotta be an Oscar de la Renta. This very pale blush color is absolutely stunning, regal, and I would still say very bridal. Maybe if you were having your second ceremony and you had already had your first wearing your white dress, you could opt for a colored dress. Or if there's a color that specifically goes so well with your skin tone and you feel so, so, so good in, and you're like, white washes me out. Don't tell me white washes me out. I will be getting a tan soon. I got that comment the other day and I'm like, girl, settle down. Who What Wear also mentioned color, but I think that the way that they showcased the dresses made me just feel like they were dresses I would wear to attend a wedding or as a bridesmaid. They're very simple until we get to this Temperley bridal, which again, I just don't necessarily see that as a bridal dress, but I mean, to each their own. However, this is the one that absolutely threw me off. Black dresses are a very big trend in regular fashion for summer 2023 and spring 2023. And apparently they are also trending in weddings. When we are thinking about fashion, we're thinking about global trends, but who sets these trends? Specifically mentioned in The Knot, it's the land down under that really gives us a lot of inspiration. Yes, you Australians, I love you so much. I buy so much of your fashion from so many places, and apparently you've also been setting the pace for wedding fashion and bridal fashion. It's absolutely no argument. All of these dresses are stunning. For myself personally, I can never picture wearing a black dress on my wedding day. But for others, this could be like the dream. That Galia Lahave dress is stunning. Next up, we've got shorter hemlines, another one that I think it was 5 out of 6 or 4 out of 6 had mentioned. Vogue cited shorter hemlines as seen by Zoe Kravitz at her Parisian wedding. And we also saw in, you know, the past, Audrey Hepburn in Funny Face. Shorter hemlines have started to really make their main stage. What I want you to think of after looking at all of these photos and really just critically thinking about it, shorter hemlines don't necessarily mean a mini. And second dress is also an option if you want to have a long dress for your ceremony and a shorter for your reception for some fun. We'll get to Sophia Richie's wedding in just a moment's time, or even if you were having a beach wedding. I love this first photo here because it showcases how a midi dress is also an option. We pay so much money sometimes for our wedding shoes. Maybe you are more of a shoe girly than a dress girly, and you're like, these are the shoes I have to wear on my wedding day. The dress I don't care about as much. You want people to be able to see it. And in that last one, the blazer dress, that would be so cute for a civil ceremony, in my personal opinion. I've seen that a few times and I always swoon over it. Brides mentioned raised hemlines as well, kind of doing that midi length ball gown, something you may not have considered. And Mary Claire showed off how so many different dresses can still look so bridal depending on your own personal style in a quote unquote midi. Carats and Cake specifically cited this as minis, and they did show off that tuxedo dress, which again, I think would be amazing for a little civil ceremony. Carats and Cake also showing love to Monique Lhuillier once again with a floral mini dress. You've got color, you've got floral embellishments, you've got the mini, and we are weaving all of those trends together. That is something I've noticed a ton. And this brings us so nicely to the next trend, which is the second dress. I feel like because we had been having those micro weddings, it just didn't seem realistic to have a second dress with the way that the day would likely flow. But now again, like those weddings are getting bigger and bigger, you do have time to introduce a second look if that is something that's really important to you. And the second dress could be a transition piece or into a mini dress. One thing the Knot was citing that I love is if you are a bride who desperately loves two very different types of dresses, save up and make it happen for yourself because this is your big day. Vogue mentioned this one part of the article that I was like shook by. This bride, she's actually wearing a bodysuit that is her front bodice, her top bodice, and then the skirt detaches and a new skirt comes on. So maybe during her ceremony, she had that big, nice train. And then for the reception where she's moving around and dancing, she changed out that skirt. This is a way of maybe shortening that budget and having the option of those two dresses by just changing up that skirt. I couldn't do a wedding video without mentioning, I would arguably say, maybe the wedding of the year. I mean, I am getting married this year, so I won't take too much offense to that statement. But of course, it was Sophia Richie's wedding. Oh my goodness, this wedding is like the wedding of dreams, and she's wearing Chanel in both of these for her ceremony and her reception dress. Next up, we always consider what we're wearing at the beginning of the day, like we picture putting on our dress, but then sometimes it can cool down, or maybe we want to be a bit more conservative. You can always add capes and jackets. And capes, oh my goodness, before designing my dress, I had never considered a cape before, and now if I was gonna make it, this is something I would consider. Could that be me? Mentioned in Who What Wear, it's that very ethereal lace cape that is worn here in Savannah Miller's dress, and she self-designed that dress. In these other photos too, just while you look at them, something I also want you to think about is if you are someone who just really, really doesn't wanna wear a veil because you don't want it attached to your head for whatever reason, you know, you could still have that feeling of wearing a cape versus a veil. And I've actually seen veils where they're attached from shoulder to shoulder and flowing off versus on your head. So something to consider, especially if you really don't want to wear a veil. You could also still wear a veil if you have a cape. And look at this Temperley London one. So regal. We also have jackets. I actually just purchased this tuxedo jacket from Zara. I'll try to find it. I purchased it a little while ago, but it's just that extra little thing that I can add to my bridal looks, especially if the temperature goes down. Plus, some brides just might opt to wear it the entire day. Who What Wear showed us so many different ways of having a jacket, whether you have that coordinating lace suit, which I think would be so cool for your rehearsal dinner, or even this Karen Millen one, a really nice high street choice where this is quite literally the mix between a cape and a jacket. The second one, the Rixos one, also integrates that little bit of maximalism with the feathers at the cuffs, and note those bows on her as well. This is our last main trend, and that is editorial choices. And by this, I mean if you don't see yourself in any of these dresses that I have shown you, whether that be the minimal or the maximal ball gown, an editorial choice could be a very unique design. And that is elegance deconstructed according to The Knot. This is elements of deconstruction where you see kind of the sleeve falling down or these little elements that all come together to create your wedding outfit. Even these little straps here that you're seeing on the Nardos, this is courtesy of Nardos, this last one here, even those little strips that are coming off are a very good touch to mermaid core, which is a huge trend this year. And again, we're seeing that in brides as well. Mary Claire specifically called this modular moments. So it's kind of that architectural design of an outfit that you can choose. Specifically, I'm looking at this top one here, where it almost like you have the mini underneath. And I wonder if that skirt actually comes off at that bow, so it's two looks in one. So those were our top 10 trends, but don't go anywhere just yet because there are two notable mentions that Who What Wear had alone that I thought, hey, I feel like this could be a great mention, even though it wasn't seen across the board. And the first one is personalized pieces. We've got a little bit more time. We've got the power of Etsy, and I'm sure a lot of cricketers are out there ready to personalize all of their wedding pieces for their bachelorette. Well, personalized pieces could be that detachable skirt like Halfpenny has created and cited by Who What Wear. But what I'm really thinking about is the embroidery on a veil. I remember seeing kind of Mrs. whatever on the back of a veil or on gloves. I've seen Till Death Do We Part, those kind of fun things, if it's your vibe. And that little cover up as well by The Own Studio. I feel like that is such a cool little add. and then you could remove it later, but it's not necessarily a full-on jacket or a cape. And last but not least, we have got rent, rewear, and reuse. There has been, over the past few years, an absolute upswing in sustainable choices, which is incredible, and as well, some studios like Fitzroy Rentals, for example, downtown Toronto. I'm from Ontario, Canada, very close to Toronto, and I love the ladies at Fitzroy Rental, and I have rented a ton of beautiful gowns from them before for events, and this is maybe an opportunity for you to wear a designer that you can't necessarily afford, but you could rent for one night and still feel absolutely fabulous. Plus, I mean, I'm not gonna lie, probably a lot of us don't wear our wedding dresses again, so this kind of avoids it being in your closet for the end of time. Some other ones that I've heard of as well are by rotation in the UK, and I'm guessing that these other ones are some as well, the fall recycle and circle. These are all of the publications that I used to create this video. A huge shout out to all of the authors of these articles for truly doing their own individual deep dives. I always appreciate your work and it helps me make these. Give this a thumbs up and please do subscribe if you like this video. I put a lot of love into these and every single like is so helpful for that little YouTube algorithm. I love you guys so much and I truly cannot wait to show you my own personal wedding dress this year, and sneakily doing this video and seeing all of the different trends, I see a lot of cross-section with what I have chosen in my design to what is trending, which makes me so excited. That will be coming up in a future video, the whole behind the scenes of how I put together my wedding dress, so be sure to subscribe. And guys, without further ado, congratulations, you got this. Have so much fun trying on wedding dresses if you are in that season of life right now, and just take like only a couple people with you, seriously. Seriously. Plus, it takes about 8 to 10 months to really get that wedding dress complete, from being chosen to production to having those alterations. So get in there as soon as you can. I'll love you and leave you, and we'll see you in the next video. Bye, guys.